This is Duke University.
Welcome. My name is Peter Fever, and I'm the director of the American Grand Strategy Program, and I get to welcome you to one of my favorite events that AGS does. Every year for a while now, we've been having a focus on women in national security, and we've brought back very young alumna who have are just making their way in their career and come back with tips for the other students on how they can make it in their career. And we're not doing that tonight. We're doing something just a little bit different. We're able to hide, piggyback off of another event that is bringing back some of Duke's finest. And when we heard that they were coming, we said we have to grab them and do a special version of this night. And it's so special that I have to get off the stage quickly. All I get to do is introduce a student of mine, Mo Hartney, who is in her second year at in the MPP program. She served for 6 years in the Air Force, had a connection there with the A-10. Fair warning, Secretary James, for an A-10 question coming your way. And now she's getting her MPP, and then future great things await, I'm sure. But her first step to greatness is moderating this panel and introducing our distinguished guests. So thank you. Please join me in welcoming Mo to the stage, and then Mo, take it away.
Thanks. So I don't think I need this. I think I'm mic'd up already. But I'll try not to mess it up too much. It's honestly an honor to be on the dais with you two ladies. Thank you so much for coming. And before we start the program, I just want to thank some of the co-sponsors of this event. So thank you to the Triangle Institute of Security Studies. Thank you to the AGS program itself. Thank you to the Department of Political Science and, of course, Sanford School of Public Policy. And as you see from the uniforms in the audience, we have all three branches of the Duke ROTC as co-sponsors. So thank you so much. You know, without your co-sponsorship, this event would have been possible. And in terms of the event itself, we'll try to go to about 7:30, but we really want to open it up to questions from the audience to give you time to ask the questions that are on your mind. So about 20 minutes before we end the program, I'll open it up. And there's a mic down here on the bottom floor and then a mic upstairs for those of you who want to ask questions. So in terms of introducing our distinguished guests, the first person I'll introduce is Secretary James. Of course, the acting Secretary of the Air Force. She is responsible for organizing, training, and equipping the entire Air Force, so that means the Guard, active duty, the reserves. She also oversees the Air Force's budget. Before going to the Air Force, she held a variety of leadership positions at SAIC, including Senior Vice President, Director of Homeland Security, and more recently, she was the President of the Technical and Engineering Sector at SAIC. In the position, she was actually responsible for over $2 billion worth of revenue. So you can see she's got some experience with money, so we can ask her about the budget. And some of the Budget Control Act things that we've been seeing. Before she went to SAIC, she was actually in the Clinton administration. She worked in the Pentagon. So she was a senior advisee on Guard and Reserve issues. And then before that, she has a decade worth of experience on the Hill as one of the permanent staffers to the House Armed Services Committee. And then for Director Sue Gordon, she's the Deputy Director of NGA, which is the National Geospatial-Intelligence Agency, which is the intelligence agency that's responsible for imagery intelligence in terms of the intelligence community itself, and it's also a combat support agency, so we'll ask her about her connection with the military as well. And before she went to NGA, she had 25 years worth of experience as an analyst and as a leader in the CIA. So that's definitely something that we want to touch on. And the leadership position she held there, she was a director of the CIA's Information Operations Center, and you were also the CIA director's senior advisor on cyber. So how to integrate cyber into the CIA's activities, but also what to do about the cyber threat. So that's definitely something that's on our mind. You also
something
that we'll talk about. In terms of other positions that she held in the CIA, we were talking upstairs that we might get into some of the big data questions and how to partner with industry, and that was something else that she really spearheaded when she was in the CIA. Both of these ladies are Duke alums, so they both hold bachelor's degrees from Duke, and just a fun fact about Director Gordon, she is the only person to have had 3 years worth of captainships on the Duke women's basketball team. And during her senior year, they actually beat UNC, so she's somewhat of our lucky charm.
Yeah, we won't talk about the earlier seasons.
Yeah, so go Duke. All right, So ladies, I think I'm just going to open it up with a broad question so we can really start the discussion. And there are a lot of young professionals here and a lot of young professional women as well. So if you wouldn't mind, can you talk a little bit about your career and sort of the trajectory of your career, some of the challenges that you faced and how they changed over the years of your career? So some of the challenges you faced as a young woman maybe going into national security, and have you seen those challenges evolve, or are there any new ones facing young women today?
Great. Well, I'll start off if that's all right, Sue. And thank you, Mo. Thank you, Peter. And thanks to all of you for turning out and spending some time with us this evening. It is certainly a pleasure for me to be back here at Duke. I was just here in October, and I hope there'll be some other opportunities to come back as well. This location didn't even exist when we were here at Duke. So I'm class of 1979. Should have been the class of 1980, but I actually went through Duke in 3 years and got my degree in comparative area studies with a minor in Spanish. So back when I was attending Duke and when I left Duke, I went on to Columbia to get a master's degree in international affairs. I had a very specific dream, and I had a plan, and I had it all mapped out. And that dream was I wanted to be in the Foreign Service. I wanted to be a diplomat, and I thought I had everything going my way. I had a fantastic education. I took all the right coursework. I got top grades. I even had internships as a young person that related directly to the field. And so I really thought I had it all together. I moved to Washington, D.C. right after Columbia and applied to the Foreign Service, which if any of you are familiar with the procedure, there's both a written and an oral exam. And I sat back and I just waited for that acceptance letter to come rolling in because, of course, there was no internet by then. You know, this was the early 1980s. And you may guess where I'm going with this story. So the first big lesson I learned in life is life doesn't always turn out as you expect it will, and it doesn't always result in successes. So instead of getting an acceptance letter, I got a rejection letter, you know. Dear Ms. Roche, that's my maiden name, thank you for your interest in national security, but we won't be requiring your services at this time. And I remember I just crashed. I thought, my life is over. I've spent all these years working toward this goal, and it's just shut down. Boom, it's gone, just like that. And I just literally, I think, spent 3 or 4 days in bed crying. But then somehow on the fifth day, I got up and out of bed and thought to myself, well, I've got to have a job. And so I started applying everywhere else I could think of in the federal government because I did want to be in government. I wanted to do policy and was accepted by the Department of the Army. That actually was my first job out of school. And it wasn't my heart's desire, but it was a job. And I was so grateful to have a job at that point. My dad had been a World War II vet. But other than that, I had no knowledge of the military. And in those days, I wasn't even particularly interested. But I had a job. And so I went to work in the Department of the Army. And it was a few months later that the most remarkable things started happening for me. And those remarkable things were, it was really interesting and important work, number one. And I was working on important national security issues that I read about every day in the paper. And I felt like I was making a difference. I had my role, and my role was small, but I was learning, and I was making a difference, and I felt that way. And I liked my colleagues. I was learning from my colleagues. And they were good people, and they took me under the wing. And I had a great boss who was my first big mentor in life and opened doors for me. And I met people and had experiences because of this boss. And so from that first failure, because remember what I just said, I had a great big flop early on, didn't realize my dream. But that opened up a whole other avenue for me that I otherwise would have never been exposed to. And from that point to now, it's been 34, 35 years, and my whole life has been devoted now to national security and national defense, that angle. You heard everything I've done to include industry. And actually, I am the Secretary of the Air Force. I got the battle wounds from Senate confirmation to prove it. So I actually did go through Senate confirmation. And so, again, my first big lesson learned in life is be prepared to zigzag, because things won't always turn out as you think they will, but that doesn't mean they can't be fantastic. New doors open when other doors close, so you must always remember that. And then the second big lesson learned, I already mentioned it, is the power of mentorship. If you don't have one at the moment, seek one out. Just go ask somebody who's doing something you're interested in, have a cup of coffee, and hear their story, because it can be extremely valuable and you never know what will come from that. So that's the second lesson learned for me in life. Let me stop there and let you tell some stories.
I need to work on my agent so I don't have to follow your your stories. Okay, so let me see if I can give you something different. I was a zoology major at Duke. We can talk about my leadership lessons, or would you like to hear about my honors thesis? Yeah, you would? It was the structural and mechanical analysis of the mesoglea of sea anemones. Incredibly relevant to what I'm doing now. So the truth is, I came to Duke. I love science. I love the engineering aspects of zoology. When it came time to graduate, I couldn't decide if I wanted to go get my PhD or whether I wanted to go to law school, because, man, I love a good argument. And so I thought, you ought to get a job. And my dad was career Navy, and a great friend of our family was Stan Turner, who turned out to be the director of Central Intelligence Agency at the time. And he said, you know, Sue, you'd be a great spy. Really, seriously, see this face? What do you think? Absolutely not. But I applied, and I got a job at the CIA, and I was slated to do analysis of foreign biological weapons. But it took 9 months to get a security clearance, and it was 1980, and it was a downsizing. And by the time I got my clearance and arrived shiny new, ready to go, the job was gone. And so I was walking the hallway looking for something to do. And I found a job. And I didn't have, unlike Secretary James, I didn't have a life's quest. My life's quest was I wanted to be on the short list for all the cool jobs. No, I'm just fundamentally curious. So I looked around for a job, and they only had one that I could get, and it was a current intelligence analyst, and the job was to take what were called launch summary reports from the National Security Agency that detailed the technical details of Soviet, that's how old I am, missile launches, and my job was to turn them into English so they could be read. You know, and I would take MECO and BECO and turn it into range and altitude. And that was my first job. How do you get a job like that with a degree in zoology? I convinced the guy that mechanical engineering was really applied zoology, and that I had and that I had studied the parent discipline. And oh, really, seriously, frictionless joints, baby's knees. You know, I-beams, rib cages. Really, materials in living systems are so far superior. I think they decided I was too dangerous to be on the street. So that was my first job. It didn't last very long because I wanted to do more than just reporting. And so I got a series of jobs doing technical analysis of Soviet weapon systems. Worked, like you, for great bosses. I was in a 700-person office, and there were three professional women. And I only know this in retrospect, because when I was doing it, I was kind of nose down, focused on just being good. Because my thought was, if you're just great, the organization doesn't really have a soul, right? And so it's going to use talent. So I learned to be good. And here's my first big lesson. You are not stuck with the knowledge you have when you start. So I learned communication systems, and I learned satellite control systems. And after a while, I got a job building satellites. I know, how is that possible? And I took a job building the first-of-a-kind satellite. And Sue Gordon, tip number one is, if you ever get a chance to do something that's never been done before, leap at it. It'll change your life. And then I got a chance to go into management. And I love leadership. And the reason I love leadership is it gives you a chance to do more than your resources alone will allow you to do. So here I am, I've done space systems, I've built spacecraft, I'm leading analysis of Soviet space systems right in the middle of the Soviet space race. I briefed President Reagan. Sally Ride is calling me on the phone, and my boss said, Sue, we'd like you to lead a unit that does information technology. And I said, no, absolutely not. And he said, no, 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 we really need you to. And I said, no way. I said, that sounds hideous. And back in 1989, that was the girl job. And I was the cool kid. And I was pretty confident that I was being shunted aside. And he said, no, I really need you to do it. And so I said, yes. And my second tip, number two, is if someone you respect asks you to do something, say yes. Because almost everyone I know, and I heard it in your story, has this moment where they did a took a job that they didn't think was going to be it, and it turned out to change everything. And for me, as much as my trajectory was on this technical space building business, it took a turn into information technology, and that changed everything. Especially, I would say the second half of my career was allowed by that move that I didn't want to take. You will have jobs, as I did, where people ask you to do things that you don't think you can do. Never decide ahead of time what you can't do. If someone thinks you can do it and it's something important, say yes. And then do your best, learn what you need to do, and succeed. So if you take my career, my big lessons are never cut yourself off early. You are not stuck with the knowledge you have. And the greatest key to success is being good. And if you do walk down your careers with your head up, you will be shocked at the opportunities that will present themselves to you, even if you're a zoo major from Duke with an honors thesis on the mesoglea of sea anemones.
Thank you. As you're talking about young people moving into federal service, and you're talking about the resiliency that you need to really, you know, make it from a potential failure into a success, or do something that you didn't know that you wanted to do, and it really became the thing that sort of defined your career. How are you dealing with recruiting young people, or maybe the right kind of young people, if there is such a thing, into federal service? And how do you deal with the management of talent?
So in our case, in the Air Force, of course, we're trying to recruit some fantastic young people into the uniformed service, either active guard or reserve, and then we're also always trying to recruit talented people into the civilian side of service. So we have great opportunities in a whole realm of career fields there as well. Some of the things that we're trying to do, obviously, we're promoting scholarship opportunities. We, of course, advertise targeted at certain types of people. What we always try to sell, if we're selling anything, relates back to what I talked earlier, the importance of the mission, how you'll be part of an organization and teams, and you'll meet people that will be focused on problems and solving those problems that are much bigger than any of you or much bigger than me as an individual. I think that's really the magic of government service. Frequently, we can't compete with the private sector. If it's sheer money against money, these things don't always compete well, right? But we feel like we have a mission to offer. And as I said, we have opportunities for people across the gamut. Another thing we're trying to focus on is we're trying to get the message out that although in the military we're a very structured type of a place, we're also looking for increasing ways to be more flexible. And we're looking, although we have fantastic people, we're looking to always expand our horizons to have more diverse people from different parts of the country, different gender, or both genders. Obviously, we have women in the military, but we recently have opened up more positions to women. Women can now participate in virtually anything for which they qualify. So we're trying to get the message out. We're a diverse group, and we want you in our midst, provided that you, of course, live our core values, and provided also that you meet our high standards, because we do, in fact, have high standards.
She said it perfectly. Our biggest attractant is a life of purpose and the great challenges that come. In intelligence, I think that we also add in that intellectual curiosity piece. What I say about intelligence is if an equation will solve it, you don't need us. If I try and judge whether someone would like the business of intelligence, I usually say this: raise your hand if you like solving jigsaw puzzles. You like jigsaw puzzles? Yeah? Yeah, how about, would you like to do it if you knew that a quarter of the pieces were gone? Yeah, still, you're in, right? And how about if you don't know what the picture is? Still, you're there? And how about if in 5 minutes the president wants to know what you think it is. If you like that, intelligence is your game. But it's a life of purpose. I agree with Secretary James, and the Air Force is really leading the way on this in terms of the flexibility, in terms of thinking about how we have the careers that not fit you into the way we like to do things, but be the type of organization that will allow you to bring who you are, because we know that's our future.
Yeah, when I was at NGA, I was seeing sort of the buildup of big data and the rise of activity-based intelligence and how you could see patterns from intelligence. And I wanted to ask you if you had seen any changes in the candidates that you're trying to recruit. Are you looking for different kinds of factors in the ideal person, maybe the flexibility that you were thinking about, or the ways that people think? Are you looking for anything different in the young professional today than maybe you would look for in the 1990s before big data came about?
So I'll start and then you fix it. In 2016 and beyond, you cannot be uncomfortable with technology. You are going to have to be a comfortable data swimmer. There just isn't that separation. Particularly as in intelligence, images are no longer going to be pictures. What we're able to do is take all the information content out of that image and then know every feature that was in that and for every image ever taken. And it isn't going to be a world as much of causality, because that's the way intelligence really was when I started. It's a world of correlation. How do you take discontinuous geographic events or asynchronous temporal events and still find patterns that are meaningful to reveal activity and even better, anticipate what's going to come? And so even if the foundation of that is understanding what is going on geopolitically, even cyber isn't going to be cyber, it's about how you affect national intent through cyber, you are going to have to be comfortable technically. And so I think for any discipline, having an ability to be comfortable with data, with technology, is just going to be a requirement for any discipline. Even if you're a polyscientist or an economist, you're going to have that other element.
No, I totally agree. I was going to say science, technology, engineering, math, STEM. Right. I think that's a acronym now America is fairly familiar with. And although you need not have a degree or a background in STEM to be able to come into the military or to become an airman, certainly having that facility at a minimum and to have such a background is also a plus. Though I want to emphasize any major in college or any background in high school, still we welcome all types of people because we want diverse thinking in the Air Force. But to have that facility is key. Another thing that is key for us, and I dare say this goes for the entirety of our military, is we need people who are agile, quick thinkers, they're comfortable working in ambiguity. Because life is not always laid out in precise patterns, and things change constantly, and you've got to be prepared to pivot. So people who can think in those sorts of agile ways. We have incredible opportunities for very young people in our military. That's both for young officers and young enlisted people. We put enormous responsibility on their shoulders. And then the final point I'll leave you with is there's fantastic leadership opportunities. So anyone who is interested in, as Sue said, management, or I would call it leadership, but being responsible for other people, taking care of those people, organizing those people for a purpose to go and execute on a certain mission, wow, the military is something you definitely ought to check out, because you can get opportunities to lead in ways that you would never be exposed to in the private sector. I know, because I've been on both sides, and they simply don't exist until you are much, much more advanced in your career when you're on the private sector side.
And Director Gordon, you were talking earlier about your experiences with the industry sector and sort of what you can take away from the industry. And actually, I know that in the Air Force, you have opportunities like this. And one of my friends is doing an internship at Coca-Cola, mm-hmm. so learning some of the things from industry as well. Can you talk about a little bit about maybe commercial off-the-shelf technology as another option for the military or something else we can take from the industry partners and use it to better national security?
So I think it's the magic happens when you take the purpose and resources of the government and the energy and industry and innovation of the private sector and you slam it together and really amazing things happen. So one of the greatest opportunities I had was when the CIA recognized that it was not taking advantage of information technology at the rate it was being produced. And because our processes were so slow and so closed that we were increasingly dealing with technology that was too old, we decided we needed to come up with a way to better reach the industry. And we went to the private sector and we asked them to start a company that would take our greatest challenges and look for companies that we could keep alive just long enough to let them take hold, and then they would produce commercial capability that we could then buy. So different model than other public, than other government use where we would bring the technology and we would own it. This was inspire its growth so we could use it, but it would be existent and advancing its own pace. And so that was the company that's now 16 years old called Incutel. And Incutel had some great advances. Google Earth came as an Incutel company. Palantir, there are a lot of good ones. But this idea of combining the two is really important. The challenge that the government has is how are we open enough to acquire the capability that is being produced at an alarming rate and use it fast enough when we are designed to be slow, right? And that seems counterintuitive, but you in fact want the government to be a little slow. You don't want an activist government. You want to be able to count on it. You want it to be transparent and you want it to be fair, but it can't be ponderous. And so this is a really interesting challenge for new partnerships. I think what industry is finding is the same things that Secretary James said about why individuals come to the government. It's why companies want to come to the government, because they're trying to decide what to do with all the potential and what the real problems are. So I think there is a great opportunity for new age public-private partnership, because what's being produced in the private sector is so relevant, but the use by the government will drive it to even greater heights. And we could talk security technology is a great example. You know, banks can decide that they can lose $1 million a day because they can decide that that's the value proposition. The intelligence community can't lose one secret a day. And so who do you think's the better driver of security technology? The government. But who will take advantage for societal gain of that advance? The private sector. The banks may not have paid for it, but the banks will drive it if they can use it. So really interesting possible combinations.
I think the number one thing that I would like us see, like to see us take more of from the private sector goes to this issue of process. How do we speed up our process in government? So we'll never be exactly like the private sector, and Lord knows we'll never be like Silicon Valley in terms of speed and agility. But I'd like to see us, you know, speedier than what we are today, because what we are today is just simply not satisfactory. I think the reason why we are as slow as we are today and as cautious as we are today, having been an observer on the scene, as I said, for 35 years, it seems like we build a system to prevent whatever the last scandal was, whatever the last problem was, that blew up, hit the press, Congress got involved, maybe new laws were passed, maybe we imposed more regulations ourselves. It's a combination of all of those things. And so we build a system which is designed to protect against what happens 3% of the time as opposed to a system that would help us the 97% of the time when we get it right. And the system is very risk averse, it's very slow. So I think many of us in Department of Defense are in our own ways, and there's several blanket approaches that DOD is taking, but then, for example, we have some complementary approaches in the Air Force, all of which are designed to, in one way, shape, or form, speed it up, streamline, make it easier for some of these Silicon Valley or other similar companies who aren't used to doing business with the government, help them to have better access to us. So speed it up, get more innovative companies who don't normally do business with us to try us out. And we think from doing that, that would produce, you know, better products, and we too would speed things up. So I think it's the number one thing I would like to get is more speed.
I think there are, just to push on that for a second, I think that one of the mindset changes that we have to have in the government is when you're buying a tank that's going to be around for 20 years, you better nail down the requirements, because that is a massive acquisition and you have to be sure. It could be faster too, but if you're acquiring a piece of software that's going to be obsolete in 2 years, that's just the way it is, can you spend a year on the requirements for that? So just recognizing how it's materially different is something that we need to do.
And thinking about agile thinking and you know, ponderous processes, the budget comes to mind. And so I'd like to hear your thoughts about the Budget Control Act and how you balance risk and readiness in both the military and sort of how you develop your priorities in the intelligence community as what is now the, you know, the most prominent threat that you're facing. And how do you deal with that, you know, the myriad of threats and what your priorities could be?
Well, I think the Budget Control Act, aka sequestration, which is this automatic capping of each individual account within the military and creating automatic reductions if Congress and the President don't come to agreement on overall spending, I think it was a stupid approach which nobody at the time ever thought would kick in. And yet the law of unintended consequences kicked us all. And it did kick in the year 2013, and we all suffered for it. I mean, ridiculous decisions had to be reached because of this automatic mechanism called sequestration. So if there is a bit of good news out here, although we're still in a, you know, a tough budget environment, we now are operating under 2 years of relative stability, where there is a bipartisan agreement as to what the top level on defense spending will be, and same way for the non-defense portions of the budget. So in other words, they've agreed at the top line, the same for the intelligence community, which at least means we're not lurching toward government shutdowns every other week like we were in a period of lurching toward those shutdowns. It didn't quite give us everything we wanted, but, you know, it was reasonably close, and so we're grateful to now have that stability. But we're now in the, we just rolled out the FY17 budget. We're currently in FY16, and FY17 is the last year of this bipartisan budget agreement, which means come FY18, we're right back to square one and sequestration, unless something else happens. So Congress has to pass a new law to trump the old law of sequestration, which will automatically come back. So, you know, you learn to be grateful for whatever you get, and we got 2 years, but what we really need is we need sequestration lifted, and we need people to sit down and reach agreements. And, you know, you guys know you're in the School of Public Policy here. In order to get to an agreement, when different people have different ideas, you win some, you lose some. You got to give, and you hopefully you're going to take as well. And that's the way, at least when I was on Capitol Hill, it used to be done. But nowadays, it just seems to be such divisiveness in Washington. We've had just too many difficulties to get there from here.
Organizationally, you asked the question about risk. I think everything Secretary James said, and we've now discovered why sequestration happened, because she's not on the Hill anymore. you would have never let this happen.
When we were in charge, this didn't stuff.
Totes my goats. Organizationally, What's really interesting when you're in whether sequestration or reduced budget, how do you decide what you do? And organizations favor the current. And the greatest challenge is how do you get your organization to take risk with the current to allow the future? Because what you mostly see, if you go to any organization, you say, okay, we've got less money than we planned, what are we going to do? What they will do is they will mortgage the future. Because that which you have not yet done is, by definition, not as important as that which you're doing, and that's completely fallacious thinking. You have to learn to take a risk with the current, particularly in a dynamic environment that we have right now. But how do you get your organization to see that? Because organizations are just made up of people with programs who have certain jobs, and you're asking them to do something that is counterintuitive, to accept risk with a known capability that has known benefit in order to allow the room you need in order to create something that has no yet proven value. And so I think that's, when you're running an organization, one of the most interesting challenges for me is how do you shift where you take your risk and how do you quantify that, because the future never has as much value as the present.
Right.
Except it does.
Except it does.
Except it does, right? And so that's just a really interesting conundrum in this type of budget environment, when you can't make the kinds of decisions that you would otherwise make.
Definitely. I think that it also applies to the inter-service and inter-agency dynamics as well. So would you both talk a little bit about any kind of parochialism you see with the services sort of competing with each other, or maybe the CIA asking for a lot of resources that now you as an NGA rep are like, well, actually, we need these resources as well. So how do you deal with the competition and everyone asking for what the programs that they honestly think are the best programs to move forward with?
In my case, having served in the Pentagon in the 1990s and now, of course, being back in a new role, but having seen it 20 years apart, I will tell you, I think it has come leaps and bounds from where it was in the 90s. I won't say there's zero parochialism, but it's a much more joint environment. It's much more collaborative than it was. And, you know, I wasn't there in the 70s, but I have to believe the 90s we'd made great advancements as well. Then there's also another form of parochialism, and I'll say that comes down to between the executive branch and the legislative branch, right? Because, of course, you have congressmen and you have senators, and one hopes that they'll look at the big picture of national interests, and some certainly do, but every single one of them has a state or a district, and they have a constituency, and quite rightly, they are representing that state or that district and that constituency, and sometimes the national interest and the individual local interest may not be the same. And so there's another form of, you know, can we convince the Congress? Because ultimately, as you know, we propose, but they dispose, and the president can veto, but you usually get a law which is about 1,000 pages long, and if you disagree with, you know, three things, they've got to be three really important things for the president to veto. So lots of things happen that there isn't necessarily agreement from the executive branch, but nonetheless, this is the system and one has to go along with it. But I'm only trying to bring out that we have parochialism within the executive branch, but then there's also the congressional piece, which is, of course, huge in our lives, those of us who deal with the budget.
I agree that if you look at the intelligence community 10 years after its formation, so the intelligence community under a DNI that had only that job is a post 9/11 organization. And when it was formed, if you were at the Central Intelligence Agency, you thought it was, what are you doing? We're the Central Intelligence Agency. Why do you need a Director of National Intelligence? And for about 5 years, I think we still operated as stovepiped agencies. For the last five, we have made huge strides becoming a community, having shared purpose, thinking about, and if we had all the heads of the intelligence agencies standing on this stage, they would all talk about the same issues facing the nation to which they contribute. 5 years ago, they might have been standing on that stage talking about their particular organization. So I think we've come around a lot. So NGA is both an intelligence organization and a combat support agency. I think the biggest challenge there isn't really parochialism. It's how do you advance at the same rate, making budget decisions because each one is dependent on the others that are timed properly to fit into what the other ones want. So NGA does mapping, geography, and cartography in addition to satellite imagery. I want to get out of the paper business. It is expensive, it is heavy, it is really, really difficult to move those damn maps around. So I want to go completely digital. How do you think the services feel about that? Right, because if they haven't advanced, I mean, if they haven't moved to the point that I have so that everyone is carrying a mobile device that I can download, that's an interesting challenge. So I think where we still have it is when you're modernizing, particularly between organizations that cross boundaries, how do you modernize together so you're making those decisions? Because some of those decisions are not just about capabilities, they're about efficiency. And when you're outside your organization, efficiency isn't nearly so interesting as capability. So I think that's where you still see the rub, is how do you precess together?
And speaking of modernizing and sort of optimizing, making sure that you have the right capability, a lot of people have thought that the use of drones and the use of cyber is almost furthering a civil-military gap where the people in the cadet uniforms might need to know in the future where a lot of civilians haven't actually had contact with a military officer. They just don't understand what's happening. And do you think the use of this sort of precise and almost surgical and almost a little too distant capability is furthering that distance between what we can do militarily or in intelligence and then how the civilians see the way we take action around the world?
So I don't think so. No, that's not the way I look upon it. The way I would look upon it is shame on us if we failed to leverage whatever technology, whatever advantage we possibly could to save lives. And so, of course, the use of remotely piloted aircraft, which is what we call, as you said, drones. And the reason why we're sticklers for that phrase, remotely piloted aircraft, is because the word drone connotates that there's no human in the loop. And although there are no humans in the air with RPAs, I can assure you there are plenty of very qualified humans on the ground who are involved with the mission. But anyhow, I mean, this is a fantastic technology which allows us to put, you know, a precise, very precise steel on target, as they say. And in so doing, we don't put manned pilots at risk in the air, and we're able to deliver very, very precise effects so that we get the person or the target that we're after with little to no damage in the surrounding area. Now, is it perfect? No. But let me tell you, it is an advance in precision warfare like nothing we've ever seen before in this world. And same basic story, I think, on cyber, right? Cyber, if we have the right intelligence to go with it, and if we can deliver an effect which avoids putting a weapon, a kinetic weapon, on a target, why not? Why not? That's leveraging technology. So I don't see that as either one of those as furthering a military-civilian divide, but rather I see it as advantages for the United States in order to be able to conduct the missions that our military is called upon to do.
Yep. If I had any population here and I chose cyber as an example is, you know, everything that happens in cyber resolves to a physical location. And so even though some of these technologies are extending our reach, they are not separate from physical decision making. And I think that's something that our officers and our operators of all these capabilities understand. They are not remote from the decision making and from the action, and they understand that it resolves physically even if their reach is extended and their precision is enhanced because of it. So I'm totally with you on its value. And what I would just say is the decision making is as sure as any physical act.
And before we open it up to the audience for questions, I feel like I would be remiss if I didn't ask you about what's going on in the news and get your perspective as senior leaders in national security. So Tim Cook just sent out the open letter to Apple consumers saying that he's not going to allow, you know, the decryption of data and not going to give it to the FBI. Not necessarily asking for your comments on the law enforcement side, but how do you really balance the private security and national security, and do you buy in that it is a balance and a trade-off?
Well, I do buy in that there is a balance and a trade-off, and I admit I'm a comparative area studies and minor in Spanish major. I don't understand all of the intricacies of the technology to the extent that a Tim Cook understands such things. But I'm here to tell you, there has got to be a way. There has got to be a way to stop people who are using these fantastic technologies, and they are using the miracle of the internet, and they're also combining those things with our American values, and they're turning it back at us, and they're trying to kill us. There has got to be a way to defeat that. So I don't have the answers, but to me, it is worth trying to defeat, and we better put the best technology minds together with the best government minds and figure out a way to get beyond this whole problem.
I feel so strongly about this. I do. I think it's a balance. And one of the things I like to remind everyone about is there are people, if you serve in the government, you swear to uphold and defend the Constitution. I think people forget that. And there is a balance, and you can go too far, and this is powerful technology, and you have to be governed, and you have to have governance. But there is reason on both sides that has to be found. I'll choose Europe instead of the United States. Post-Snowden, extreme reaction on data and shutting down Google and allowing searches and cutting off all sorts of personal information. And then they realized how many foreign fighters were coming back in Europe from Syria. And all of a sudden, their view about what they needed to have access to in order to ensure public safety entirely changed. I think we have to be careful because we're a revolutionary people, right? This nation was formed on the premise that the power would always be in the people's hands, and we never wanted to trust the government so completely that we couldn't be certain. That is to our core, and I think that's what we feel now. But there are threats that we are facing that have to be addressed technically. And if we're the only ones, as Secretary James said, that are following a set of rules that are limiting our eyes and ears, that is a really interesting challenge about what we will allow and what we don't. There are failures that could come if we don't get this right that make failures of the past seem teeny. Worth it to discuss. Worth it for industry to think about how they can be the holders of data? Because I'm totally down with you don't want the government holding all the data. But if industry is going to hold the data, then they have to figure out how they can be responsible with that data for its use. If I were to choose any area of policy, I think digital data policy, cyber policy, one of the most interesting areas that is still so undefined. And it extends beyond national security data. When I think about the real data challenges, it's about what's going to come when we can map the genome and all your data, about all your future history. Because, you know, the genome doesn't change. And when we get so that data is available and accessible to everybody, how is that going to be protected? data rights, data policy, data sharing, data use, national security, huge area. But don't be narrow in thinking about it. Don't choose one side or the other because the solution isn't on either end. It's in the middle.
Thank you. And with that, we'll open it up to the audience for any questions that they have. Again, one mic in this level and one mic on the top. If anybody has any questions. I see my classmates up there. I know somebody's got some. Luke.
Ask a question to Secretary James.
Well, actually, my question is for both of you. So this is, I'm in a class, and we're studying the intelligence community. And one of the themes of the class has been the clash between the intelligence community and the services for the budget. So it's cool that we have one person from each of those sides of the coin, if you will. I know we're all one team, right? But could you talk about points of friction that have been a major problem, and then also points of agreement that maybe people like me who study the conflicts forget about sometimes?
We had disagreements there, Sue.
Oh.
Go ahead, you go first with this one.
No, we'll choose space is a great example. And space is so interesting right now because for so long we had such advantage, and now it's contested. And it's not just contested with our adversaries, it is commercially contested and really interesting looking at. But one of the areas that I think the intelligence community and military is about what capabilities do you need in space? At what time? In a finite budget, how do you choose? And what do you choose to maintain? And how do you choose to use it? And imagine in wartime, do you shut off your intelligence so you can do combat support in a region, or do you need the intelligence so you know what's going to happen? If you believe that you're going to start losing satellites, how do you choose what you're going to want to build? Do you throw away peacetime capability that allow you to know what's going to come in order to have the ability to cover massive amounts in area? So I think that when it comes down to a finite capability, intelligence tends to not want to destroy things and have long strategic pieces of information so that it can know more. And the military has to have information so they can do things. And when those two things come in conflict in a finite budget environment, that's where you get conflict. And the requirements that you adjudicate in the things that you build and in the use that you have.
That's actually a great example, but I'm going to turn it around and say this is an example where there used to be, I'll call it huge stove piping, and very rarely was there crosstalk, at least that's my impression. But today, it's much, much better, much better. So case in point, obviously the intelligence community has assets in space, and the military also has assets in space. And if anybody hasn't been tracking on space issues lately, just let me tell you, space is, from a military perspective, enormously important. It's everything from missile warning to communications. To environmental monitoring, aka the weather, which is important to know about for military operations. Surveillance, you know, seeing what's happening. All of these things are important for a military perspective as well as from an intelligence perspective. It's also important for precision targeting. So the targeting I talked about depends on the GPS in space. And I dare say we've all forgotten how to read real maps because we all use GPS in our civilian lives as well in so many different ways. So for all of these reasons, space is extremely important. So what's happened? Well, people have caught up with us and people have been developing and investing in ways that are worrisome to the United States. The Chinese, as a matter of fact, are the biggest case in point. It's been all over the news that they actually delivered a weapon into space some years ago and destroyed one of their own satellites just because they were testing and they did it. So that's what's called an ASAT, and it was extremely worrisome to the United States. So what to do? So here's what we're doing. We're, first of all, changing our mindset, the way we think about space. So everything else in the military, we think about if a conflict were to come, how would we do that? We have concepts of operations. We do war gaming. We practice. The space arena, we had never done that before, believe it or not. We operate our satellites, but we weren't in that mindset of what would we do if this, that, and the other happened. Well, now we're gearing ourselves into that mindset, and we're starting to think through things like war gaming and practice and so on and so forth. The other thing that we're doing, which is going to sound very simple, but it hadn't happened before, is we're actually sitting side by side in a new center that we've established with the intelligence community. It's out in Colorado Springs, and this is where we're going to do some of our experimentation and war game and figure out, should it come to this, how would we together protect and fight the constellation through a conflict, which no doubt would start on Earth, but what if it bleeds into space? How do we defend ourselves? And so we're now sitting down jointly together, and we're thinking that through. So this is an area that used to be extremely stovepipe, but I'm going to turn it into a good news story because it's one where I think we're making a lot of good progress right now.
And I do, well, yes on both. I'll choose cyber as another example. I believe in perfect advocacy yielding good decisions. So perfect advocacy is each person understanding what their role is and holding onto it staunchly right up until that moment that you have to decide on something together. And so I think that's what is happening now with space, as you do. Cyber is a great example. So let's say that you know that there is an IP that is being used for attack. Do you shut it down? I don't know. What if you can watch the actions of the actors and so you can understand who's behind it? So do you let it stay open? So it's an interesting, there are interesting different missions that you have to sort out. I think it's productive conflict. I don't think it's adversarial conflict in order to be able to find the best way forward.
Thank you.
Anybody else have any questions? All right.
Oh, now we're on.
Look at it. No, you're good.
Hi. I'm Cadet Torgas. I'm in my second year, Army ROTC. And aside from an aspiring soldier, I'm also a software engineer. Something that's recently come up on my radar is a fairly new branch of the Army. Cyber, you've mentioned it a lot. I guess my question is more from both an intelligence perspective and a military strategic perspective, what do you think the role of cybernetic operations, both in an offensive capacity and like looking at the rise of, you know, organizations or operating organizations like Anonymous and like the Chinese and Russian hackers that have posed problems. What do you see the future of cyber looking like?
I'll tell you, it's a growing field without question in the military. Again, it's growing in all branches of the military. It certainly is the case for the Air Force. A key problem that we have, and I'm pretty sure all the services have, is that we have the bulk of our resources today, and when I say resources, I mean money and I mean people, who are devoted to operating the network. And by the way, cyber is one of those words where different people have different definitions, but you know, we tend to lump it all together, including network operations. So the bulk of our resources go to network operations at present, with fewer resources going to defensive types of operations, and fewer still going to offensive types of operations. So the big, if you want to know what the big challenge is to flip that, because we want to increasingly, through other means, like leveraging the private sector, keep our networks operating, and we want to shift those resources to defensive strategies and also to invest more in offense. And oh, by the way, when I say defense, I'm talking about defending the networks, and I'm talking about defending the integrity of our weapons systems, because all of the weapons systems nowadays hugely hinge upon software, right? So if any of those would be compromised, that would be major problems for us. So we've got to shift our resources. But bottom line, it's going to be hugely important. We already say today in the Air Force, we want to fly, fight, and win in the air, in space, and in cyber. So cyber is one of our three domains, and it's a growing field.
So I'll take a little bit of a different spin on that, because everything she said is true. I think if you imagine 10 years from now, you're not going to be thinking of cyber as distinct, because it is going to be the way by which every aspect of society is going to be affected, right? Crime, cyber, geopolitics, cyber. Wars are going to have cyber, communication, cyber, and so thinking about it as not something unique and distinct as an but as a through, as a vehicle, I think is going to be really important. One of the most interesting things about cyber defense is it is disproportionately a civilian job, right? The vectors for cyber attack are typically not through government entities, but through private sector, and how do you compel that type of defense is an interesting challenge for the nation, even as the military and the government are the leaders in that. The last thing I would say is thinking about geopolitics differently because of the reach that cyber allows. Any country, anyone, can buy an offensive cyber capability for $1 million. And if you're going to affect everything that way, how do you look at nations' actions? So it has been that conflict is basically the land next to you, but now it doesn't have to be. How do you think about China's actions because of the reach they can have economically? How do you deal with Antigua, who can affect the elections of the country next to them because they can have a cyber capability? So I think there's another whole piece of cyber is, how do you think about geopolitics differently because of the reach that cyber allows and the actions that allows that are far beyond the borders that have typically governed the actions of most nations? So really interesting field, not only technically, but also geopolitically.
Thank you.
Go ahead. Yeah, you're good.
Can you talk about times in your career when you've had a really strong opinion on something, but that opinion was contrary to the policy that the various administrations you served under wanted to pursue? And then what was your thought process behind figuring out whether you wanted to advance your thought on, you know, the administration, or you wanted to back off a little bit?
Can I go first?
Yeah, please. Gives me a little time to think. No.
It's a little relevant. What we were both laughing at is we can't remember when we didn't have a strong opinion about something. So have you heard the words speak truth to power? Okay, I hate those words because it means that, no, I do, because it means that truth is a choice and that power doesn't want to hear it. But still, it's true. So I'm going to tell you a story that taught me a lesson about opinion and not being too smug. So Benghazi, you've heard of this? So I was the director for support at the Central Intelligence Agency when Benghazi happened. At 6 o'clock that night, I was on the phone with my good friend Pat Kennedy, who was the Undersecretary of State for Management, and he was telling me that his good friend Chris, we were going to have to leave him because we couldn't find him and we needed to get his people to safety. It was the fact that we hadn't imagined indirect fire that put my men on the roof of the annex and caused their lives to be lost. So Benghazi was pretty important to the nation and to the CIA at the time because of the stories. And you remember the stories that were going around. And the CIA is a pretty contained organization. We don't like talking about stuff. We don't like talking about where we are. We don't like talking about who our people are. We don't like talking about our people being in places and locations. We just want to be quiet. And Benghazi didn't allow that. And the director of CIA at the time, the story, do you remember when the story came out? And it was that CIA didn't respond in time, right? That our officers didn't go, they were held. Well, this was anathema to the director of CIA, and he decided that we needed to call the press in, right, and tell them what had happened. How do you think that went over at the CIA? Awful. And how do you think that went over to my security officers? Worse. And so we knew this was going to happen. He was going to bring 30 reporters in, and like Pete Longstreet at Gettysburg, I went and talked to him. I said, you can't do this. The way to stop a fire is to starve it of oxygen. We don't want to admit that our people were there. We don't want to admit that we were there. We don't want to talk about it. He said, we're going to do it. And I said, I don't think you shouldn't. He said, no, Sue, we're going to do it. And I went back to my office, and my officers came back up and said, boss, you got to go back in. We got to talk reason to him. And so I went back in again that night, and I said, we can't do it. We cannot confirm the story. You just have to let it go. And he said, we're going to do it. He said, more than that, you're going to join me in the sessions, right? I went back in the next morning. I gave it one more shot, right? This is what you do. You speak truth to power. This is what you can count on me to do. I was sure that I was right. sat in that session with 30 reporters, and you know what happened? That story went away. Now, the larger story about the politics around the Benghazi incident, but with the story that went away was this notion that the CIA hadn't answered the bell. I was wrong. So the interesting thing that I learned in that, and I'd do it again, because I think if you have a job, you're supposed to do it. But there are days when you have a strong opinion and you play your role and you're absolutely certain, and there's a possibility that somebody knows more than you. And so the interesting thing about that, a lesson learned late in my career, is that it's important to do your job. And it's important to be confident and to play your role. But it's also important to allow the possibility that you don't know everything in the entire universe. And knowing that that's possible will allow you to be a much more responsible citizen.
Mm-hmm. Right. Boy, now. That was a good story. I don't think I have a story quite that good. I was trying to think
I didn't tear up this time, though. I usually do on that story.
Yeah, no, that was an excellent story. I must say, when it comes to my work with the two administrations that I've been involved with, I really can't think of a single issue where I felt so strongly when it didn't go the way I was recommending, and I felt so strongly that I ever considered, for example, resigning or taking action that way. I guess I've always been able to accept, as long as I feel like I've been heard, as long as I feel like appropriate to my position, I was given a chance for input, and as long as I feel like my boss at least gave enough time to hear me out, to think it through, because remember, those above us, and we all have bosses in life, they have to weigh different points of view, they have to weigh different factors. I had my point of view, the factors that I was focused on, but there were other things at stake. And so luckily, I've never been asked to do anything that was illegal, immoral, anything that ever made my my compass feel wrong. So I've never had that experience. And certainly not everything I've recommended has always gone my way, but I guess I have been fortunate that I have been I've been heard. And so I've been able to accept that. Now, I have tons of, not tons, but I have several stories where, like Sue, I mean, not monumental, this was a monumental type of a situation, but I'm the mother of children who are now grown. They're 31 and 30 years of age, respectively. And there have been times when I've given them advice, and I've been absolutely certain, you know, that of course I'm right about this. You just can't see. You're too young. You haven't had the life experience. And I've turned out to be wrong. So my point is, I like your story because it shows that based on all of our experience, we all have perspectives, right? We know our own truth, but frequently truth is not absolute. There are some truths that are. Integrity and ethics are absolutes, but there's a lot of gray areas out there, and sometimes we can't see the full picture, and sometimes we are wrong. So maybe that argues in favor of don't be so absolute in your opinions.
Yeah, do you have time for a quick story? Do you have time for a real quick story?
We're on a roll now.
Yeah. So, no, this is it. So one of my big leadership lessons is always remember that you might be the jerk. You know, it's really important. So here's the story that is going to be seared in your mind. I have a good friend who's an operations officer that's a spy. And, you know, if you're a spy, she was taking an airplane trip. And if you're a spy, when you get on an airplane, you're making a decision about the person sitting next to you, right? Do I want to befriend them? Do I want to recruit them? Or do I want to shun them? I mean, there's just only three choices. So she's going on a long trip, and so she's in business class, and she gets on, and she has her bag, and she pulls out her water, she pulls out her iPad, she pulls out her headphones, and like me, she pulls out her very, very favorite treat. Fudge stripe cookies. Do you know what fudge stripe cookies are? Those little shortbread and they've got fudge. Oh, they're like the best cookies ever. And she pulls them out and she sits them on the little seat thing between her. You won't believe what happens. The guy next to her takes one of her fudge stripe cookies.
That is low.
No, it
That's
is, right?
Low blow.
And she looks at him and so she grabs purposefully another one of the fudge stripe cookies and goes, purposefully, clearly expressing her displeasure. Now she's like, I don't know what to do. Should I shun him? He's feeling like a shun guy, but he might be recruitable, so I'll keep going. So she's adjusting herself. They've taken off. Guess what he does? He grabs another one. And she's like, what? Now she slams on her headphones, she pulls out her iPod, and she eats one. Really livid. I mean, she's just seething that he's done this. Guess what happens next? He looks at her, and the front chair quickly, and he kind of nods at her, like, well, would you like one? She's like, no. And so she takes it and eats purposely, and he takes one at the end. Flight to Australia happens. She doesn't say a word to him the whole time. When they land, she's getting her stuff. She still hasn't looked at him. She can't believe this. She pulls down her bag to put everything else in it. She opens up her bag to stow her headphone, her iPad, and what's in the top of her bag? Her fudge stripe cookies. She had been eating his.
Oh, wow.
Remember, you might be the jerk.
Thank you.
All right, Pat, I think we have time for one more question, as long as you make it fast. I'm sorry for the people in the back. We've got to wrap it up.
All right, it will be short. Madam Secretary, Madam Director, thank you for your comments tonight. My name is Pat Howell. I'm a second-year PhD student in political science. And tonight you're talking to a room full of younger folks, and a couple, more than a few will probably end up in the national security apparatus somewhere. Normally I like to ask the question, what skill, knowledge, or attribute should they try to develop so they can be better? Let me ask you a different one, because you already mentioned swimming data. What skill, knowledge, or attribute should they not bring with them into the national security apparatus? What would be a bad habit to bring?
The belief that if it's difficult, you're not supposed to do it.
Okay. And I think we've hit upon something with these previous stories, absolutism. So don't be closed-minded. Don't think you have all of the answers just because you've got, you know, a great education, and you do have a great education, but you don't have all the answers, and be open. You need to be open to a variety of perspectives.
Short enough, Mo?
Yeah, it's good. Thanks. All right, well, ladies, thank you so much for being here for this panel. And Pat was absolutely right that some of the people in the audience are going to grow up and be the leaders of the next generation in the national security apparatus. And your perspectives are incredibly valuable. So join me in thanking Secretary James and Director Gordon for being here.